omnium rerum principia parva sunt. The beginnings of all things are small. Your legion had marched into a wide valley pocketed by veils of what you all referred to with the contemptuous slur of Britunculi breath. This translated directly to nasty little Britain's breath, but the meaning was more akin to nasty little inbred Britain's breath. The valley which funneled into the Siluri lands was lined with slopes of various inclines and elevations. Trees of both pine and leaf grew throughout. The legion itself slithered through in a marching line some 3.5 kilometers long, and had just scouted a camp for the coming night upon a meadow atop one of these slopes when the attacks began. The Siluri, colored blood red on matching war chariots, armed with throwing spears, accompanied by their infantry armed with sword and shield. They descended like locusts upon your legion. Word was received that the auxiliary cavalry had charged and had not been seen again, and that multiple cohorts had been lost. As the fighting raged, one of the tribunus angusticlavius, or senior officers, was near your contubernium, exchanging shouts with your primus pilus centurion justus. You could not make out the details, but if it involved the tribunus punius posthumus, it would be important. For now, your task was to hold the perimeter with your men. A group of Siluri, almost as if sensing your mixed attention, let loose a volley of spears. Instinctively, you screamed for the testudo, but your men, after years of fighting alongside you, in only an eye blink, raised their shields. The spears clanged against them. Cornelius, the tall, lean comrade of Lucius, had a spear take out shoulder flesh, but he merely grunted in response. The predictable surge of Siluri infantry next swarmed in, but you again held them off. Justus was now directly behind you, yelling for the archers to preserve their arrows for infantry charges only, which you recognized meant your cohort was now cut off from the supply chain. Turning slightly during a lull in the fighting, your eyes met those of Justus, who now stood directly behind your men.
"Men, we must hold them off until darkness. The Legatus has sent word via Tribunus Punius that we are to..." He hesitated slightly before continuing. "Tactfully retreat under the cover of darkness. We are to meet 1 kilometer north of the camp we directed 2 nights ago." He then abruptly ended his speech with a yell of testudo as another volley of spears was hurled in your direction. You noted with comfort the presence of the archers and felt with what supply they still had left of arrows, nightfall would be achievable. But Caesar had himself said, "No one is so brave that he is not disturbed by something unexpected." And as if even destiny was on the side of the Siluri, the rain began to pour. If the mist was the putrid breath of the Britunculi, surely this was the passing of their water. You knew well the problem with heavy rainfall. While it could assist in slowing down a highly mobile enemy that was running on foot or on chariot, it would also wet the sinew of the bows and render them near useless. Predictably, over the next hour of fighting, the arrows fired grew more and more infrequent. Each wave of Siluri was killing more and more of your fellow soldiers. You echoed the hesitation Justus had in the delivery of the news to withdraw with disdain. "Surely," you thought, "we could have at least fought to the higher ground." However, discipline for some armies could be a thin blade of grass growing against the elements, subject to bending with each breeze. But for you Romans, discipline was provided a strong foundation, like that of a stone wall, not meant to easily give way or waver. So you and your men and the others around you of the first cohort held fast, and like the stone foundation, did not waver. The attacks lessened as night mercifully began to stretch her dark cloak across the valley. There was no sign of the Tribunus, but Justus and roughly half of the first cohort was still holding firm the ground beneath all your feet. After several quiet minutes, punctuated only by the continued rainfall and heavy breathing of the men, Justus spoke. To avoid being seen and cut down, we must avoid fire to lead the way. Use the darkness and follow what you can of the stars when visible. We will move in two large groups to the north of the camp from two nights previous. As he delivered these final words, you heard the thunderous sound of many hooves, and then in the receding twilight, the horde of chariots heading your way. Justus yelled to brace yourselves, now standing right beside you. The chariots were bearing down to your right with Justus and the rest of your contubernium to your left. They appeared to be wanting to separate Justus in his discernible centurion armor from the rest of the men. He threw his helmet to the ground and pivoted with his arms outstretched to either side. To the left, quickly, with Claudius only, he instructed. Run! You all dropped your scutums and turned with Justus. It was clear he felt the battle could have gone differently as well from the outset, but that did not mean he was ready to die here in the woods on an island so far from home. Your group, with Justus, ran without further words exchanged. Only your collective breaths led the way through the darkness. For hours, you ran, sticking to the forests and crossing clearings only as required. You'd marched, sometimes for days on end, but this was different. Your lungs burned, your muscles ached, and they cramped. Rests were short, as the priority was getting as much distance between you and the Siluri, who were not committing massive numbers, but instead sending smaller parties of several hundred men in multiple directions. You'd managed to avoid two of these, as both were using light, and while they could cover more distance, they had the disadvantage of their night vision being impacted. An advantage your small group used to create more distance and edge ever further out to the perimeter of where they were sending their parties. The terrain became increasingly hilly and mountainous. A third Siluri party had your group now heading even further west, based on the stars when visible, as clouds still covered much of them. After an estimated 5 hours, your group could no longer sustain the pace. While you'd all dropped your shields and helmets and other unnecessary supplies within the first 100 feet of your run, you did, as instructed, retain your gladiuses. Justus was the first to speak.
We must find a place to rest. Let us slow our pace and fan out a bit. We need an outcropping to hide a fire. The darkness will hide the smoke. Each man to 50 feet for an hour. Collect any dry wood you can find.
Your next thought after Justus finished was one of shock. Firewood was all good, but you had all dropped your marching packs in the scramble, making fire without flint and steel, something you had trained for, but given the conditions with the recent rain, would be extremely time-consuming. Justus swept his gaze between you all as each of you had the same look of dumbfounded realization, and then he let out the most inappropriate laugh from deep within his gut, a laugh that rumbled for at least 15 seconds.
Oh, my little mules! Surely you did not think these burns and scars were for decorative purposes only? Surely you believe your primus pilus hadn't wandered from battle to battle with both eyes closed, with Mars kicking my arse in the right direction?
He then placed his right club hand into his tunic and pulled out a small leather satchel, of the kind you all stored flint, steel, and tinder in. Only his was tied around his waist and out of sight. And as if sensing the relief on all your faces, and the shame, Justus placed the satchel back and simply barked,
"Fan out in this direction!"
After 30 minutes, the butcher Atticus found a hollow on a slope that would be a perfect location for fire and its main benefit of warmth. You all pitched in to assist in digging the fire pit with what you could find and at just the right location to hide it from the sight of passing eyes. Justus was sat by the pit in deep contemplation, but no one said a word. The mere thought of you all having lost your flint and steel was still providing just enough shame to continue working without worrying what Justus was up to. The fire was soon started. However, while it would be a warm night, it would also be a hungry one. Even Justus was unable to produce something edible from another hidden pouch. You had found a water source nearby, something these isles were not short of. Cyprian, the tree buff, soon produced a handful of pine needles, and after three of you had carved out some
rudimentary wooden cups, he suggested adding them to some hot water. It truly was a refreshing drink, and while it didn't cure the hunger, it at least filled your belly with much-needed refreshment. Sleep came quick, but with your watch being the last, you found it difficult to again find sleep. So you stayed awake and sat with Justus, who again seemed deep into contemplation, then after a few minutes finally spoke.
"We will require ranged weapons, Gaius. You've been working on creating bows and arrows, have you not?"
"Yes," you replied. Before you could speak further, Cyprian spoke up, providing valuable information, but with a bunch of added not required as well.
"Gaius, there are some saplings from the trees the natives call Owen you could use. These trees grow larger here than the similar ones in the Empire, and while they also have needles, they are toxic to drink, but the wood is strong."
Soon, the others were up, with Justus telling the group you would rest, complete the bows, and then head further into the direction, before coming back, north and east. With the others up and assisting you, within a few hours, you had rudimentary bows. They took a bit to finish, and that was your task as the others lacked the skills you had built up. They did help, however, with the process of hanging the bows on the trees to pull the sinew and flex the bow many times over the course of a few hours to better prepare them. Atticus, lacking the deftness of Justus, was all brawn and rarely delicate with anything other than his meat cleaver. He soon broke his bow during the process. So you designed him a longer and stronger bow with a much heavier pull, the bow almost as long as Atticus at roughly 6 feet in length. You ensured it was strong enough as you had but one sinew left. Atticus was able to use the bow without issue, and after a few hours after midday, Justus said it was time to leave.
"I chose this route as prior expeditions into the region reported a type of hairy goat that roams in the higher elevations. They are easier to hunt than deer, especially given our current strength."
You all set out, and later that day recognized trees that produced the oval-shaped hazelnuts in plentiful bounty around you. You each collected as much as you could carry without your packs, and when eaten on your next rest, they did a decent job of at least killing the hunger pains. As your group continued to head west, you could see the mountains rising and soon were on the slopes. Ahead, you spotted the peak, looking like a headless neck sitting atop a set of broad shoulders. As you drew closer, sure enough, a group of wild goats could be seen grazing on its steep green slope facing you. To the peak's side, a gentler slope could be seen, proceeding up to its summit. Your group, careful to walk so the breeze did not carry your smell to the goats. You could see in the lower elevation below the goats a peat bog of the kind the natives would sacrifice criminals and offerings into. You were considered the best shot and were thus designated to make the first and hopefully only attempt at a meal that day. You approached the summit edge below which the goats were gathered and crawled the last few feet slowly so as not to make any noise. Peeking your head just over the edge, you noted it was much steeper than you'd anticipated. The goat numbered just over a dozen and were eating at the vegetation on the side. The males had large, thick horns that curved back like enormous drinking horns with the points almost touching their shaggy backs. The females, though, horned, but of a much thinner variety. You picked what looked like an average-sized male, lined up your shot, and let loose an arrow. It struck it deep in its neck. The beast, now dead, collapsed and fell several dozen feet onto a ledge below, and thankfully not into the peat bog. The rest of the goats scattered, leaving their comrade to his fate. You called the rest of the group over, and Atticus, still feeling the sting of having destroyed the first bow, volunteered to fetch the future meal. He handed you his lengthy bow, and he took two of his arrows, breaking them several times until he had a cluster of 8-inch sticks gripped firmly in each of his ham hands. He was descending at a decent pace and was soon down with the meal on the ledge, and then appeared to lose his footing, falling to his right knee with the other leg over the edge and his left arm swung behind him, which caused him to release his left grip and scatter the arrow pieces into the bog below. His right hand
still firmly in control of the arrow pieces, stabbed intuitively and quickly into the ledge, stopping his slide backwards, but not before his right leg was also over the edge. Justus, seeing this, yelled below,
"So the good news is, we had a kill, but the bad news is we now have two prey on a ledge to retrieve."
It was a needed reprieve from the seriousness of the moment, and soon you all burst in laughter. Well, save for Atticus down below, who was still hanging on for dear life and slowly getting his footing back on the ledge, or at least attempting to. As the one who took the shot and in possession of his very long bow, you scaled down in the same way he had until you were just above his ledge. You took his bow from your back and reached it down to him, telling him to grip it and pull himself back onto the ledge. This went well, initially, until he began to slip again and tugged so hard on the bow that you were pulled clear over the edge and arced over him as his left arm circled over with you. You stopped breathing, expecting to fall into the peat bog below, but instead came to a hard stop. Looking up, you saw Atticus's left arm unnaturally twisted back and could sense he was struggling to hold you both up. Still firmly clutching the arrow pieces in your left hand, you stabbed into the side of the summit just as his grip loosed, catapulting the very long bow into the peat bog below, where it would likely lay for a very long time, if not eternity. And here we end part 5 of your life as a Roman legionary. What will happen to Gaius, Atticus, Justus, Cyprian, and the rest? Will they make it back, or will things continue to go tragically wrong? We'll find out in the next episode. If you like this video, please hit the like button and share it with friends, family, anyone you think may enjoy historical fiction like this. And if you haven't yet, please also consider subscribing, as I'd love to have you on board your history. Until the next video, cheers.